Hi everyone, this is Murphy Pua, the chemistry guru. Now in this video, we want to go through drawing the mechanism of alkanes, which is our free radical substitution. Now describing the mechanism is a very important component of organic chemistry in A-levels, so we need to be able to describe it in detail. Now before we jump in and describe the mechanism, let's look at this phrase, free radical substitution. Now you notice actually free radical substitution is broken into two components. The first portion here will be my free radical. Then the second portion, of course, will be the word substitution. Now actually, based on our alkane functional group, we can determine why does it undergo free radical substitution. It is actually a deduction. We don't really need to memorize that. So if we have our very simple methane as an example, if I draw out my CH4, then the first portion we want to explain is why does it undergo free radical reaction. If I look at my carbon, which is bonded to my hydrogen. In alkanes, my carbon-hydrogen bond is treated to be non-polar. And if we have bigger alkanes, let's say ethane, propane, and so on, where we have carbon-carbon bonds, carbon-carbon bond is also treated to be non-polar because there's no difference in electronegativity between carbon and carbon. So what this would mean is, in terms of the charge, my carbon doesn't have any positive charge. It also doesn't have any negative charge. Now, if my carbon is not positively charged, then it is not capable of attracting a negative species, which is our nucleophile. Now, nucleophile, we annotate it in this way. I just draw an NU minus and we draw a lone pair. So, because my carbon is neutral, then will my nucleophile attack my carbon? My nucleophile will not attack my carbon in this case because my carbon is not positively charged. Now, similarly, because my carbon is not negatively charged, so therefore it doesn't attract my electrophile. Electrophile is positively charged. We write it as an E plus. So in this case, my carbon will also not be able to react with my electrophile. There's no reaction between my electrophile and my alkane carbon. So the only species that's willing to react with my alkane will be my free radical. Usually we use a dot to represent that it has an odd number of electrons, neutral, and it has an odd number of electrons. So therefore, my free radical is very reactive and it is willing to react with my alkane, which is neutral. So we have that first portion sorted out. Now the second portion we want to explain is, how come alkane undergo substitution reaction? Why doesn't it undergo addition reaction? Now this one is easier for us to explain, because if I look at the degree of saturation of my carbon is already saturated, it is bonded to four other species. So what this would mean is, it is not capable of adding in another group. If my free radical is added to my carbon, then you have five bonds, which is not possible. Carbon maximum can only form four bonds. So since my carbon is saturated, so therefore it has to undergo substitution reaction. I think this idea is good to keep in mind. Based on the charge of my carbon, I can deduce whether it reacts with a nucleophile, electrophile, or free radical. Based on the degree of saturation of my carbon, I can deduce whether it undergoes addition reaction or substitution reaction. Now to describe the mechanism formally, let's write out a balance equation involving my methane, CH4, reacting with chlorine. Now, this is done in the presence of my UV light. Then, what will happen is I will have a free radical substitution and we will get either a monosubstituted product or a disubstituted product, or even a higher degree of substitution. So, maybe in this case, we will do a disubstitution. So, the product will be my CH2Cl2 then plus 2HCl. So this is the equation that we are looking at. So we want to describe the mechanism to show the disubstitution of our methane to form dichloromethane. Now, the first step of our mechanism is our initiation step. So of course, this will kickstart the reaction. Now, basically what happens is very simple. What I do is I just draw a chlorine-chlorine bond. Now, in the presence of UV light, what will happen is this bond will break homolytically. That means this bond will break equally. Each chlorine will take back its own electron. So what we'll do is we'll use half an arrow to represent the movement of one electron. So I have two electrons here inside this covalent bond. One electron will go back to this chlorine on the left-hand side. So this is half an arrow. One electron will go to the chlorine on my right-hand side. So this is another half an arrow. Now this is in the presence of my UV light. And what happens is, because this chlorine is taking back its own electron, you get a chlorine atom, or we call it a chlorine radical. Now this chlorine is also taking back its own electron, so you also get a chlorine atom or a chlorine radical. So you end up with two chlorine radicals or two chlorine atoms. So you notice this is an initiation step because it kickstarts the reaction, it generates my radical, and the next step will be my propagation step. Now propagation step, we will need to involve my radical since it is a reactive species. So what this radical will do is it will attack my methane. Now when we draw my alkane, it is a good idea to expand out the bonds so that it is easier for us to draw the arrow pushing. Now usually what I will do is I will recommend just drawing the bond that you want to break. The rest of the CH bonds, we can collapse them together. So I'll do in this way, I'll just write a CH bond. The rest of it will just be a CH3. So your compound will be less cluttered. It's easier for us to draw. Now, what my chlorine will do is it will steal a hydrogen from my alkane and it doesn't attack my carbon directly. Now, why is this the case? I think the easiest way to think of it is my alkane, my carbon is at the center and it's surrounded by my hydrogen. So it's easier for my radical to attack the hydrogen and steal the hydrogen rather than to go all the way in and attack the carbon which is in the middle. So I think this is the easiest way to think of it. So what you will do is you will form a bond with my hydrogen. Now from the perspective of my hydrogen, what you will do is you break up with my carbon. So you break up with my carbon and then you draw a half an arrow to represent this hydrogen breaking this bond, and then it tries to form this bond with my chlorine. So I just draw another half an arrow between my chlorine and my hydrogen. So effectively what we are doing here is I'm forming a HCl bond here. Now what happens is since my hydrogen is breaking up with my carbon, so carbon has no choice, you have to take back its own electron. So again we'll draw half an arrow to represent that the electron is going back to my carbon. So this is my first propagation step. Usually our first propagation step, we write it as a slow step. Then in terms of the product, we will have our H bonded to my Cl. So this will be my HCl. Then remember this carbon is taking back its own electron, so it becomes a radical. So I'll just draw my CH3. The dot, I'll put it on carbon because now the carbon becomes my radical. Now why is this a propagation step? Because if I look at the process, you have a radical reacting with something stable to give you something stable and you generate another radical. So the total number of radicals inside this system stays the same. So the reaction will continue. Now my CH3 becomes the reactive species. It will continue with the reaction. So this reaction will propagate. That's why we call this the propagation step. So as long as I have a radical reacting with something neutral, then you always generate another radical that's counted as a propagation step. If I compare this with initiation step, it's something neutral, it will generate reactive species, starts the reaction, that's why we call it the initiation step. All right, so propagation step, this is the first one. The second step we have to draw in order for us to form the first substitution is this CH3 must go and attack a chlorine molecule. Now, what we have to keep in mind is actually free radical substitution is a random process. Once you generate a radical, by right it can react with any stable species that is surrounding it, and that will be counted as a propagation step. But we have too many random steps. We're not interested in showing all of them. So what we do is we want to write down the minimum number of steps to reach the outcome that we want. In this case, we want disubstituted methane. That means we want to show my dichloromethane. So we focus on that. We draw the minimum number of steps for us to reach dichloromethane. So we have to settle the monosubstitution first. The fastest way is you generate my CH3 radical. The next step is this CH3, we're going to attack a chlorine molecule. So what we'll have is this CH3 here, we're going to attack a Cl2. So what I'll do is I'll draw a Cl bonded to my Cl. Then my CH3 radical will be here. Now basically what my CH3 will do is it will steal my chlorine. So this chlorine will break up with the other chlorine, form a bond with my CH3. So I draw again half an arrow to represent that the carbon is forming a bond with my Cl. This Cl, since it's breaking up with the other Cl, it has to take back its own electron. Correct? So what you end up with is, you end up with this guy being a radical. So you have a Cl dot plus this CH3, this carbon is bonded to my Cl. So you end up with a CH3 Cl. So this is the first substitution. I think it's good to take note of it. You notice what we have is I need two propagation steps for one substitution. So one substitution actually requires two propagation steps. So if the question only asks you for monosubstituted product, then once you draw these two steps, then you're done, you can move on to the termination step. But again, in this case, we want to go through a second substitution. So we need another two steps in propagation step. so that we can squeeze out my disubstituted product. So what we have to do is we have to continue the propagation step two more times. So what we'll do is we have to target this guy, my CH3Cl, because I want a second substitution. What I have to do is this chlorine radical must attack back my CH3Cl, then I can do a second substitution. So we'll have to draw that. So the third step will be involving my Cl dot. This CH3Cl, in this case, I want to break my CH bond. So what I would do is I will draw out my CH bond. Everything else, I lump together. So this one is a CH2Cl. So you don't need to draw too many bonds. It is easier. You notice the pattern that we have for this step, in the third step, is exactly the same as that for the first step. This hydrogen will break up with the carbon. You form a bond with my chlorine. So chlorine will form a bond with this hydrogen. So you end up with a HCl. So this carbon has no choice, take back its own electron. So you end up with something like this. This hydrogen bonded to Cl, you have a HCl plus. This C is taking back its own electron. You end up with this CH2Cl. This carbon becomes a radical. If you compare the similarity, the first step and the third step, essentially it is the same. So hopefully you can see the relationship. Then after that, this CH2Cl will have to attack another Cl2 to get the second substitution. So it's effectively the same as the second step. You have a Cl bonded to my Cl. Then you just duplicate this guy. You have a radical CH2Cl. So my carbon will form a bond with Cl. The Cl will break up with the other chlorine, form a bond with my carbon. Then this bond will break. The chlorine will take back its own electron. Then finally, what we have is this. You have this chlorine forming a radical plus this carbon now is forming a second Cl bond. So you end up with this CH2Cl2. Now this is the product that we want. So what we can do is we can stop the propagation step. We can move on to the next step, which is our termination step. Now take note, does it mean that if I form CH2Cl, then the reaction will no longer proceed? And does it mean that the radical says that, okay, once my job is done, so I will go and undergo termination step? Of course, that's not the case. Again, because free radical substitution is a random process. So what this means is actually this Cl can continue to react with my alkane. I can have a third substitution. I can have a fourth substitution. You can have a lot of different products, but we are not interested in showing them because the question wants me to form a disubstituted product. I do until this step. Once I form the desired product, I will move on to the termination step. There are more steps involved. There are more propagation steps taking place, more substitution, but we're not interested in showing them for this question. So finally, we can move on to our termination step. Termination step in general is very easy. What I do is I just choose any two radicals that I draw in the propagation step. I combine them together. So the third step is termination step. I just choose any two radical. So usually I'll draw two steps. The first one will be my chlorine radical, which is this guy. The second one I'll choose is my CH3 radical. So I'll draw a CH3 radical. So basically what they do is they will meet each other and then they'll form a covalent bond with each other and they'll be stable. So I just draw the two half arrows towards each other. And then what happens is you end up with a CH3Cl because you're forming a CCl bond. So that will be the first termination step. Second termination step that I like to draw usually is CH3 with itself. So I'll have a CH3. Now if you want to, you can flip the methyl group around. So instead of a CH3 dot, I write it as a H3C dot. Then this one will just be my CH3 radical. Essentially, it is the same. So you draw the arrow pointing towards each other. Then you form a covalent bond between them. You form a CH3 bonded to my CH3. So you end up with an ethane molecule. So this is my termination step because you have two reactive species and they combine together to give you something stable. So in principle, it ends the reaction because the total number of radicals inside the reaction mixture will decrease. So we say that this is a termination step. Now one more idea we want to discuss is the amount of the products that we can form for propagation step and termination step. Now, we have to keep in mind, in the reaction mixture, you have majority of neutral species. We only need to generate a very small amount of my radical. So, usually, initiation step, we don't need to continuously shine the UV light throughout the entire experiment. or throughout the entire reaction. I only need to generate a small amount of my radical, because this radical, when it takes part in the reaction, it will propagate. The total number of reactive species stays relatively the same. So I don't need too many of these radicals. So we just need to shine the UV light for a short while. I have a few radicals inside the reaction mixture. I can let the reaction run. Then the majority of the process will actually be my propagation step. So effectively, like more than 90% of the process here will be my propagation step. So as long as you have a neutral species reacting with a radical, that is counted as a propagation step. So the probability of my radical meeting my neutral molecule is very, very high. So what this means is all these products that I can form in my propagation step are all formed in large quantities. So things like our HCl, things like our CH3Cl, then things like our, of course, the product that we want to form, all these are present in large amounts because we have a lot of propagation steps. Most of the processes that takes place during free radical substitution is my propagation step. Now, how about termination step? Termination step, because I have very few radicals inside the reaction mixture, the probability of my radical meeting another radical actually is very, very low, but eventually it would happen. So therefore, if I have processes that takes place only during termination step, that compound or that product will be found in very small amount or trace amounts. Usually, we only look out for this guy. That means the doubling of the number of my carbon. If you start out with methane 1 carbon, you end up with 2 carbon compound. This compound is only formed during termination step when you have a methyl radical meeting another methyl radical. And you notice you cannot form my ethane in the propagation step. So this CH3CH3, or the doubling of the number of carbon, is found in trace amounts. So if I start out with an ethane, a 2 carbon compound, then a 4 carbon compound will be found in trace amounts. If I have a 3 carbon compound, my propane, 6 carbon compound will be found in trace amounts. Now how about my CH3Cl? Since this is formed in the termination step, does it mean that it is found in trace amounts? Actually no, right? You notice I also can form CH3Cl in the propagation step. So this guy will still be formed in large amounts. Now I hope that this discussion will help us better understand the free radical substitution of alkanes. Now if you learned something from this video, please give me the thumbs up and subscribe to my YouTube channel for more weekly video lessons. That's all for now. Thanks for watching.